Right. So I was supposed to do this video a while ago, and I ended up going out and getting drunk, da 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 da. So the script will be on my lap the entire time as we talk about today's topic, legacy content. So let me be clear. I've tried to do this numerous times. However, the quickest and easiest way I can come about this is just by saying buy legacy content. It's really all I have. Let me explain why. When it comes to D&D, there's nearly 50 years worth of lore, be that for gods, places, people, worlds, and even events. Whilst you could sit and research all of these different things until the cows come home, you'd never get to play D&D, as you'd be too busy learning about it. These seem almost like broad blanket statements, but let me be clear. If you go to D&D Beyond, and you go to buy either Mordekainen's Tome of Foes or Volo's Guide to Monsters, it tells you to buy Mordekainen Presents Monsters of the Multiverse. The reason behind this is somewhat solid. The reason is very simple. All three of these books are essentially monster manuals, and the ones in Mordekainen Presents Monsters of the Multiverse, that's the most updated monsters. There's a lot of them that are all the same. You know, maybe nothing changes, but maybe the wording changes, and the wording can, you know, it can have effects in D&D, how you read things and how you interpret things. The issue is that with Volo's Guide to Monsters and Mordekainen's Tome of Foes, they have one thing over Mordekainen Presents Monsters of the Multiverse. Lore. Volo's Guide to Monsters is actually a canon book in D&D. You can buy this book from Volo himself at the beginning of Tomb of Annihilation, and you could probably, if your DM knew about it, swindle him into selling you a copy at the beginning of Waterdeep Dragon Heist. A fun little Easter egg? Maybe. But as a game master, the information in here is priceless, and as a player, it's good to broaden your horizons. Let's take a look at one such creature, the Yuan-Ti. Now, they both show up in Volo's and Multiverse, however, the differences are night and day here. Now, Volo's gives you lore, and I'm not just talking about on the creature, I'm talking about their society, how they operate, the different tiers in their society. It gives you an idea of where they live. It tells you how they go about their day-to-day dealings, and even their gods. That's not information that's available in Multiverse. Voldos is like rolling a nat 20 on your history check, whereas Multiverse is essentially saying, well, what do we generally know about these creatures? Let's be honest here. If we're in a Tomb of Annihilation game, I know straight I'd 100% want Volo's Guide to Monsters just because of all that information. It also has information on Mind Flayers. A deeper understanding of their hierarchy, their goals, how they're created, and their motivations. These are things that you just kind of have to assume or make up if you bring them into your game, unless you do your research. The problem is, there's either too much information or too little information. The Forgotten Realms wiki? Too much. The information that may be given in the adventure? Too little. The only problem is, Volo's Guide to Monsters is only available in hardback. You can find it in all your local shops, but you can't get it in D&D Beyond, and if you're someone who actually prefers to read things like that, then you're kind of in trouble. The same can be said for Mordekainen's Tome of Foes. There's a whole 30 pages in that book dedicated to the Blood War, and we have a campaign that takes place in the Blood War. It's called Descent into Avernus. Knowing the difference between demons and devils, their motivations, their goals, the different circles of hell, amazing stuff to have. There's also options for character creations as a tiefling, your lineage there, in case you want to maybe flavour your tiefling a little differently. This same book also has information on the Gith. Now, you might be sitting there going, the Gith? Who's the Gith? The Gith's the only predator towards Mind Flayers. You may have encountered the Gith. The first time I encountered the Gith was when I was playing Baldur's Gate 3, and I'm like, who are these lanky bastards? Well, it turns out the Gith used to be slaves to the Mind Flayers, and they broke free, and then there was the Gith Yankee, who are, you know, very much kill all Mind Flayers. They ride red dragons. Their queen is called Vlakith. They then had their own civil uprising that spawned off to create the Gith Zarai, who reside in Limbo as opposed to the Astral Plane. Relevant information to have when you're running Dungeon of the Mad Mage, and you come up against the Gith Zarai, the Gith Yankee, and the Mind Flayers. Depending upon how it's run, you may have to pick a side. It's nice to know which team is actively the best. Gith Zarai seem pretty chill. Or how about learning about the Shadowfell? There's some details about the Shadowfell in the Dungeon Master's Guide, and then Tome of Foes comes in and it gives you information on the Raven Queen and the Shadarkai Elves. Shadarkai are a playable race, it's nice to know a little bit more about them and if you want to play one. What about the Drow or the Dwegar? The Drow and Dwegar show up and down near every adventure, and the Drow, though genuinely quite despicable, it'd be nice to know any other details about them. Same with the Dwegar. The Dwegar seem like a trash mob more than anything else. They just kind of show up to die. Tome of Foes. all the information you'd ever need. This also holds true for settings, believe it or not. Anyone familiar with the channel knows that on Mondays I upload a Dragonlance game that we're playing. The opening pages of Dragonlance Shadow of the Dragon Queen specifically state that clerics have been missing for over 300 years. They just kinda and went bye-bye. Why? Well, it's not actually explained why, and believe it or not, the reason is you need to play the other AD&D Dragonlance modules or read the books to find out why. But Shadow of the Dragon Queen makes a big statement near at the beginning. Like, the cleric's been gone for 300 years, but you can play a cleric if you want. Why? That was a question that one of my players had, someone who's familiar with the Dragonlance set, and when I read about it, he said, yeah, I know, clerics have been gone for a while. And so, oh, well, you can play as a cleric here, and he said, why? Now, the book is missing tons of information. It took me quite a while to figure out when about the book takes place and the span of time. This takes place over a year. The events in this book take place over a year. And you just need to figure that one out, maybe? I mean, when I was reading the book, I had questions like, who's Takesis? Who's Lord Soth? What's the Cataclysm? Why do people not quite like Kendar as players? And also, why are the clerics been missing? Well, having read some of the first module and also having read some of the book, I found out why to some of these questions. The Cataclysm came about when Lord Soth failed to stop a King Priest from attaining godhood. Due to Goldmoon taking a staff from her husband-to-be, Riverwind, and touching a golden statue of a goddess in a shrine in the middle of the forest, she became the first cleric in over 300 years. People dislike Kendra players because Kendra's used to be a case of you did not have property, we had property. If it wasn't nailed down, Kendra's tried to take it. The Dragonlance books are from before I was born, they're from the 80s. So getting a hold of them, yeah, I'm paying like £40 a book from the 80s. A Dragonlance book from the 80s to play, and you know, it's a completely different rule set. But the information in there is priceless. We've also discussed how I don't necessarily like reading, so I'm not going to buy a 300-page novel. Volo's Guide to Monsters and Mordekainen's Tome of Foes give me information on creatures that come up all the time. If my players want to know anything about Mind Flayers, I can give them that information. If they come up against a Mind Flayer, I can easily give them the threat of becoming a Mind Flayer. And it's brutal. Old D&D books have a vast amount of useful knowledge that we really should actually be taking into consideration, in my opinion. Though some of that information may have been retconned, we're only ever told what's changed and not what remains the same, so we still need to seek that out. As a Dungeon Master, you can enhance your world with this information, and as a player, it gives you an idea of what you should expect. You can all of a sudden take something that's quite bad in your campaign and make it even worse once the players know what's at stake. It's not just they will end the world, it's you will become a Mind Flayer. You will undergo Seramorphosis. This is Seramorphosis. Things become scarier because the consequences of failure are escalated. So yeah, in conclusion, legacy content is a wealth, a font of knowledge, and it's useful to have for numerous reasons as both a player and a dungeon master. So maybe it's time you scour eBay and Amazon and try to find some of those older legacy books to try and get some more information on some creatures and some worlds. Expand your world for your players and immerse yourself in all the lore that's out there. Till then, guys, thank you for watching, and maybe soon you'll get a video on Insight or a rant on Insight. Until then.